gonna send a blood, gonna drown a man. This is brave, this is bruised, this is who I'm meant to be, this is me.
The convention of the National Federation of the Blind is now in order for our afternoon or morning session, depending on where you are, anywhere and everywhere. Welcome, Federationists. We are going to begin this session with an invocation from a member that many of you will know. He is a rising second-year student at the Meadville Lombard Theological Seminary, one of the two seminaries in the country that specializes in the formation of potential ministers who will serve in the Unitarian Universalist faith tradition. He is currently a ministerial candidate in the process of achieving full fellowship within the church. He lives in Concord, New Hampshire, where he currently serves as the administrator of services for the blind and vision impaired, the state's vocational rehabilitation program for blind, vision impaired, and deafblind individuals. A longtime member of the National Federation of the Blind, I'm proud to introduce Dan Fry. Dan, we need you to unmute.
There he is. I'm unmuted now.
There he is. Welcome,
thanks.
Dan.
Thank you, Mark. I appreciate that and apologize for the slight delay. Please join me in a spirit of prayer. Spirit of life, spirit of love, goddess and god of many names and no name at all, the blind of America have assembled in our thousands to continue to carve out a destiny for our community, to advocate for our dreams, and to support one another as we face a world of disadvantage and discrimination. Moreover, our delegates this year will be called to grapple with issues that may strengthen the character and integrity of our organization. Toward this end, we ask that you, Spirit of Life, grant us grace in our deliberations. Grant compassion to those who need it. And grant love to us all, so that when we finish this convention, we can join united in our primary purpose of promoting opportunities for people who are blind. Spirit of Life, we also ask that you take into consideration the needs of the broader world, recognizing that we as blind people are part of that broader world and have a part to play in its operations. Just as we are interested in programs that impact us, we also accept a reciprocal responsibility to be interested in programs that impact the world. May you be well. May we be well. May they be well. May it be so, blessed be, and amen.
Thank you very much, Dan. Appreciate the sentiments of that invocation, and thank you for being with us at this convention.
Thank you.
Let's go to a door prize to kick off the session.
Good afternoon. So we will be giving away a $50 Visa gift card to the following people. The code word is Sun Fund. So Mark Harris from Missouri, Barbara D. Collins from Oklahoma, Michelle Monsivais from Texas, Amisha Shaw from New Jersey, Talia Anderson from Washington State. Again, the code word is Sun Fund. Please raise your hand using the Zoom features or email prize@nfb.org. And I apologize for mispronouncing anybody's name.
Introducing our dad,
the president of the National Federation of the Blind, Mark Rigabono.
During the past year, the depth of our determination and the power of our bond in the organized blind movement has been tested. Going back to our founding in 1940, you will find no year like the one through which we have persisted. Social distancing protocols and considerable uncertainty forced us to suspend the hundreds of conventions, meetings, seminars, and community outreach events that typically represent our annual effort to organize and strengthen our movement. But the blind of America have not retreated from our mission, nor have we slowed the pace of our progress. Instead, we have transformed our movement, creating new ways to organize and discovering strength in the new dimensions of our march together. While the COVID-19 pandemic and the resultant social and economic dynamics have tested our movement, the record will show we remain stronger together as blind people. We have encountered many unexpected challenges, but we have responded with love, hope, and determination. We have fulfilled our pledge to stay together, to transform dreams into reality. We are the National Federation of the Blind. Throughout the pandemic, the advocacy work of the Federation has been essential for connecting blind people to resources and protecting them against unequal treatment. At the beginning, the availability of public health information, accessibility of testing sites, and adequacy of economic relief were our focus. Our efforts later expanded into equal access to vaccinations. Many Federation members reported that the websites used to register and schedule appointments for COVID-19 tests and vaccinations were inaccessible. While access barriers on websites are something that blind people must overcome daily, issues on these sites put blind people at greater risk for transmitting and suffering the effects of this deadly virus. We have raised this concern with the relevant federal officials and have kept it front and center even through the transition of presidential administrations. Additionally, we raised our concerns with three of the leading entities that partnered with state and local jurisdictions to offer COVID-19 vaccinations. Albertsons, ZocDoc, and Curative have all responded positively, and we are now in negotiations to get their vaccination and testing websites made fully accessible on rapid timelines. We expect these relationships to cause positive transformations in future healthcare sites established by these companies. This year, the popular media has covered the importance of vaccine trials in proving the efficacy of proposed cures. The media has not covered the fact that individuals are often left out of these trials simply because they are blind. One example is Chris Sabine, who is a member of the National Federation of the Blind of Ohio. Mr. Sabine sought to participate in a COVID vaccine trial. Negotiated a training on blindness and best practices for preventing discrimination, which took place at the hospital on Global Accessibility Awareness Day. Together, we transform denial into education to inoculate against discrimination, and we hope that only one shot is required. Many schools and testing entities have responded to COVID-19 by permitting participation using remote technology. The inaccessibility of these technologies has been a significant problem for blind students and blind parents. Consider a blind second grader in Berkeley, California, who we will call KW. He loves to dance, learn about astronomy, build with Lego bricks, and read Braille. KW independently participates in classroom activities using access technology and refreshable Braille. However, his equal participation was significantly diminished by the accessibility barriers in the technologies of his virtual classroom, including Seesaw, a learning management system, Epic Books, an online library, Zern and Prodigy, systems for math instruction, and Loom, a video player. We will not tolerate second-class education for our blind youth. On behalf of KW and his parents, the National Federation of the Blind has begun negotiations with the technology providers to ensure that digital K-12 learning technology is an enhancement to educational opportunity rather than a barrier. Furthermore, we are working closely with the school district to achieve a model technology procurement policy that prioritizes accessibility. as with all of our efforts, the goal is for this policy to serve as a model for school districts across the nation. We are transforming America's educational system to empower rather than exclude our blind youth. Many jobs in the American economy have been transformed during the pandemic. However, blind entrepreneurs operating under the Randolph-Shepard program in federal and state government facilities have been especially disadvantaged. Beginning in March 2020, our governmental affairs staff worked closely with the National Association of Blind Merchants to seek targeted relief for blind small business owners across the country. Unlike other small businesses that were able to make transformations in their business models to bring in some income, blind people in this program had no access to their businesses, their inventories, or their customers due to government facility closures. For blind business owners, the New Year's celebration came a few days early, as on December 27, 2020, the president signed an act to authorize a one-time $20 million emergency relief and restoration grant program to offset losses of blind vendors resulting from the COVID-19 pandemic. We aggressively followed through to ensure that the United States Department of Education gave appropriate guidance to state licensing agencies, and by the early spring of 2021, blind business owners were finally receiving the financial support they needed. Once again, the National Federation of the Blind has transformed difficult circumstances into greater hope and opportunity for the blind. The American democracy places a high value on the ability of individuals to cast an independent and private vote in elections. Yet, our nation has not come to a day when all blind people have equal access to the full process of registering, independently marking a ballot, and privately casting their final vote. Thanks to the National Federation of the Blind, we are making steady progress toward that day, and we can count the last year as a significant milestone in advancing toward our goal. In the run-up to the 2020 federal elections, many jurisdictions expanded absentee voting because of the pandemic. We found that most states failed to make their absentee ballots accessible despite the Federation's prior legal victories and guidance. We engaged elections officials, wrote letters, published op-eds, and or filed lawsuits, or some combination of these, in at least 19 states, including Alabama, Connecticut, Delaware, Illinois, Iowa, Kentucky, Maine, Michigan, Minnesota, Nevada, New Jersey, New Hampshire, New York, North Carolina, Pennsylvania, Rhode Island, Tennessee, Texas, and Virginia. In most cases, the state, by settlement or through pressure from the court, either contracted with a remote accessible vote by mail system or made PDF absentee ballots accessible for the 2020 election. Whenever possible, our national organization led a coordinated effort, including local affiliates, individual federation members, and other interested organizations such as protection and advocacy groups. These collaborative efforts allowed us to provide both the legal expertise and arguments and the real-world experience of blind people to help educate judges and state officials on the importance of accessibility. As a direct result of the Federation's efforts in these cases alone, over 11,000 blind people and people with print disabilities were able to vote absentee in the 2020 presidential election, a vote they would have otherwise been denied or had to risk exposure of the virus to cast. Through our Help America Vote Act work, we continue to educate elections officials, protection and advocacy personnel, and voting system manufacturers on non-visual access issues. Starting with the 2008 presidential election, the National Federation of the Blind has offered a survey to capture data on the experience of blind voters every 4 years. Among those completing our 2020 blind voter survey, 64% voted in person at a local polling place, while 36% voted absentee. While the growing experience of blind voters using remote accessible voting systems is improving privacy and independence, we cannot ignore the importance of equal access at in-person polling places. One success from the past year is the resolution of a lawsuit against the Maryland Board of Elections for their failure to protect the right of blind people to a private and independent vote at the polls. After defeating the board's motion to dismiss the case, we came to a mutual agreement on a statewide plan to increase the use of accessible ballot marking devices and poll workers' familiarity with them. The board also agreed to pay our attorneys' fees and costs. No matter how often the state of Maryland, or any other state for that matter, puts barriers in our way, we will transform them into equality for the blind. In 2020, we hosted our first ever virtual national convention, where 10,000 individuals engaged in the seminars, workshops, exhibits, and business sessions of our organization. We were disappointed that the uncertainty of the pandemic continued into the fall, but we knew without doubt that the blind would show up to greet the 117th Congress in the winter. On February 8, 2021, we gathered for our first virtual Washington seminar, with more than 400 meetings engaging more blind people than ever before. We have again made the priorities of the organized blind movement clear, and we have laid the groundwork for years of work ahead. On March 1st, 2021, We celebrated the date after which all hybrid and electric vehicles must be manufactured to meet the minimum sound standard established by the Pedestrian Safety Enhancement Act, which had been a priority of our Washington seminar more than a decade earlier. When we come to the halls of power, we know that transforming our priorities into reality takes time, energy, and lots of follow through, even after the heavy lift of getting a bill signed into law. We do not give up until we have passed the final milestone. The most persistent example of our tenacity is our quest to eliminate Section 14C of the Fair Labor Standards Act, which permits unequal and substandard pay for people with disabilities, a quest that began at our founding in November 1940. I am proud to report that we are getting closer to this goal every day. While we continue to build support for the Transformation to Competitive Integrated Employment Act in Congress, an increasing number of states, agencies, and organizations are adding their support to the message we have shared since 1940. In September 2020, the United States Commission on Civil Rights released a strong report on the intersection of civil rights and employment of people with disabilities. In October 2020, the National Council on Disability released a similar report on the unintended consequences of the Ability One program and Section 14C. Both of these significant reports clearly call for the repeal of Section 14C. Most surprisingly, an April 2021 consensus letter to congressional leaders, co-signed by National Industries for the Blind, the National Association for the Employment of People Who Are Blind, and Source America, marks a significant milestone in our quest for the first time ever, these entities acknowledged and affirmed the long-standing demand of disability advocates to eliminate special wage certificates. One simple sentence in the letter sends it all. Quote, "We agree," end quote. I will let you decide for yourself why this 2021 declaration is surprising. We are not done, and we will not take the pressure off until we transform the laws of this nation to eliminate unequal treatment for people with disabilities. A full report of our advocacy and policy staff will be given later in this convention. Similarly, the Amazon Corporation has once again learned that the organized blind movement does not quit. Last year, I reported that we filed several complaints with the Equal Employment Opportunity Commission on behalf of five blind people who were hired at Amazon fulfillment centers only to be placed on unpaid leave as early as their first day. This was not because they failed a background check or drug test, or due to their violation of company policy. They were simply blind. It puts a smile on my face to report that we have delivered a settlement with Amazon that will open new opportunities for the blind in its growing number of fulfillment centers. beginning this month, Amazon has agreed to adopt technologies and accommodation solutions to make many fulfillment center jobs accessible, to work with us to identify accessibility innovations, to provide online training internally on accommodating blind employees, and to conduct outreach efforts to the blind community on these efforts. The company also reinstated and accommodated the four individuals who still wanted to work in Amazon warehouses, including backdating their benefits to their original start dates. Many blind people know the pain of being rejected for a position before an application is even submitted to an employer. The National Federation of the Blind is prepared to fight against the discriminatory actions based on blindness that bar us from equal opportunity to compete for positions. One example is our filing of a complaint with the Massachusetts Commission Against Discrimination on behalf of Roger Sullivan regarding discriminatory hiring practices by National Telecommuting Institute. Specifically, NTI tells applicants that it cannot accommodate individuals who use tools such as JAWS, magnification greater than 2X, voice recognition software, or relay services. We will not allow employment opportunities to be denied to individuals who request these accommodations, and we will continue to transform the employment prospects for the blind. Some of the most damaging discrimination comes when we have work that we are passionate about, but we are forced to endure the stress of harassment and low expectations from our supervisors. We have the security of knowing that the National Federation of the Blind continues to use the force of law to raise expectations. In a proceeding before the EEOC, we fought hard against the Department of the Army on behalf of a blind child care worker, Olivia Chamberlain, who had faced discrimination, harassment, denial of accommodation, and retaliation because of her blindness. Despite her successful record as a child care worker for years, Ms. Chamberlain's supervisor repeatedly made offensive remarks about her disability, demanded a list of job tasks that Ms. Chamberlain could not perform, and disciplined her when she defended her rights. The agency intentionally delayed acting on her accommodation request for 10 months and demanded unnecessary medical information. Finally, even after agreeing to some accommodations, they failed to follow through. With the transformational support of our movement, we reached a settlement agreement for Ms. Chamberlain that secures the accommodations she was entitled to, and that promises the dignified treatment she deserved. The agreement also provided her with a job transfer that she wanted. One more example of the power of our movement and the strength of our togetherness. We continue our work to ensure that support programs administered by federal, state, and local governments provide meaningful access to blind people. Christopher Meyer is a Federation member from Indiana. In 2017, he had his Indiana Medicaid terminated because he had not responded to a print mailing telling him that he needed to submit additional information to maintain his eligibility. The print letter was delivered despite his prior request that all correspondence be sent in Braille. Even if he had known about the request, Christopher would have needed to overcome the inaccessibility of the online Indiana benefits portal. On behalf of Christopher, his sister Sarah, and the National Federation of the Blind, we filed suit against the state to secure equal access. The court issued an order finding that the state's websites are part of their programs and activities, and that failure to offer accessible programs violates federal disability rights law. In May, we finalized a comprehensive settlement agreement in this case that ensures that Christopher, Sarah, and all other blind Hoosiers will be given their choice of alternate format for print communications from the Indiana Family and Social Services Administration, the Division of Family Resources, and their contractors. This agreement will also, these agencies will also achieve and maintain the accessibility of their websites and benefit portal. In North Carolina, we found that UNC Healthcare and its associated Nash General Hospital failed to provide blind patients with accessible copies of critical documents such as consent to treat forms, after visit care summaries, and medical bills. We wrote to UNC Health and asked to work collaboratively on a solution. UNC Health declined our offer, so we went to the courts. In November 2020, we reached a $150,000 settlement with Nash General Hospital while continuing our legal battle with UNC Health, which includes affiliated medical providers across North Carolina. Both sides have moved for summary judgment, and we are awaiting a decision. We hope this case will send a message to healthcare providers throughout the country that they must plan for the timely and consistent provision of documents in accessible formats to blind patients. Jamal Mazrui is a member of the National Federation of the Blind of Washington and a retired federal employee who received health insurance benefits through Blue Cross Blue Shield's federal employee program. For years, he has been unable to access information about his benefits because the BCBS program's website was inaccessible. Thanks to a transformational lawsuit filed by the Federation, federal employees, retirees, and their families will now be able to fully access all insurance benefits information that is on the Office of Personnel Management's health benefits website. Significantly, under the settlement, OPM will require all of its insurance carriers to make their federal employment benefits websites and apps fully accessible. BCBS will be bound by the OPM requirements. We will not tolerate being prevented from accessing the benefits and services we are entitled to receive. And we celebrate our Federation family members who have taken courageous steps to transform their frustrations into effective communications for the blind. The National Federation of the Blind continues to lead the way in ensuring equal access to self-service kiosk technologies, which have grown in popularity during the pandemic. Two recent examples come from California. When the California Department of Motor Vehicles implemented new self-service kiosks in local communities, they apparently assumed blind people had no need to pay their car registration and print registration tags. However, we know that while blind people are not legally permitted to drive, we often own vehicles for our family, employment, and even sometimes Federation business. California Federation members who had a need to use these machines found that the DMV kiosks, unlike ATMs and other machines they had encountered, were not independently usable through non-visual access. With the support of the National Federation of the Blind, a group of Federation members entered into structured negotiations with the California Department of Motor Vehicles and the kiosk manufacturer, Intellectual Technology, Inc., to reach a resolution announced earlier this year. As a result, ITI has now added Braille labels, tactile controls, speech output through a headphone jack, and other accessibility features to its kiosks. ITI will continue consulting with the National Federation of the Blind, and one of its machines can be found at our International Braille and Technology Center in Baltimore. As a national contractor with a presence in many states, ITI is now positioned to lead the market on accessible government self-service technology. While visiting McDonald's locations in California, Federation members Brian Barreau, Juanita Herrera, and Santiago Hernandez discovered new self-service kiosk technology was being installed without features that would enable blind people to independently use these machines. They reported their experiences to our national office. We reached out to McDonald's, and the company has worked collaboratively with us to develop an solution. McDonald's USA's corporate-owned restaurants will implement enhancements to existing accessibility features by December 31, 2021. The enhancements include screen reading software, tactile keypads, and the ability for customers to connect their headphones to the kiosk. The enhancements will be incorporated into 100% of the existing kiosks in California and 25% of existing kiosks and each corporate-owned restaurant in other states. McDonald's will also incorporate these upgrades into all kiosks that are installed in any of their U.S. locations after July 1, 2021, including new kiosks available to franchise locations. We commend McDonald's for their collaboration with the National Federation of the Blind to promote inclusivity and access. While there are those who will say that McDonald's French fries are what are truly transformative, we are loving the transformation that comes from discovering greater accessibility across the nation through partnership with the organized blind movement. Let us not forget that, as with work, we are also artificially kept out of play. Solely because of our blindness. Despite numerous blind contestants succeeding on the game show Jeopardy, one of our members recently discovered the show's updated online contestant application test was inaccessible to those using screen access software. And the answer to this non-trivial discrimination? What is the National Federation of the Blind? We reached a settlement with Jeopardy to make its online application test accessible immediately, to provide an immediate accommodation to allow our member, James Fetter, to take the test and to pay attorney's fees and damages. Jeopardy contestants, beware. The organized blind are here to play. A strong value in our movement as blind people is taking the responsibility to build our own future together. One way we do that is through the development of innovative programs that we coordinate from the National Federation of the Blind Jernigan Institute in Baltimore. Though the building has only had a small core of staff working on site during the past year, the programs have continued to grow throughout the nation. While schools across the country shuttered and moved to virtual learning platforms, our blind students needed the support of blind mentors more than ever before. Our pre-employment transition services, known as the National Federation of the Blind Career Mentoring Program, pivoted from in-person retreats to high-quality two-hour Zoom meetings held 3 times a month. We developed 28 virtual interactive modules delivering 168 student participant hours to more than 50 students from Illinois, Maryland, Mississippi, and Nebraska. The virtual modules covered a broad range of topics, including career preparation, advocacy skills, employment readiness, leadership development, goal setting, non-visual techniques, and learning through service, or what we refer to as giving back. We continued to broaden the network of mentors available to our program mentees through the Federation family. We will now begin resuming in-person gatherings, for which there is no true substitute. However, we expect the innovations of the past year to positively transform our mentoring resources in the future. This summer, we are expanding upon the innovative efforts we made in 2020 to deliver our NFB Braille Enrichment for Literacy and Learning Academy directly to the homes of families using the Zoom platform. In the NFB Bell in-home edition, we provide our Braille learners with a variety of hands-on materials, daily online instruction and support from skilled teachers of blind students, as well as mentoring from local blind adult role models. In the summer of 2020, we worked with 265 blind students. Each student received a Braille resource box weighing 7 pounds. For the summer of 2021, we have divided the curriculum into 3 separate tracks, beginner, intermediate, and advanced, to facilitate more effective instruction based upon individual skill level. In addition, we have expanded the resources sent to blind students. Depending on which track a student is assigned to, they will receive a resource kit weighing 11, 16, or 19 pounds. The program also includes social opportunities to build relationships with peers across the country. Additional supports were added to the 2021 program to better serve blind students with a variety of additional disabilities, including those who are deafblind. We have also enhanced our training for mentors and instructors through a partnership with the Consent Academy. 86 blind students participated in our first academy last month, and we have additional academies scheduled for July and August. Through our NFB Bell in-home edition, we are transforming the possibilities for the future. Literacy, independence, and the network of the National Federation of the Blind are gifts that will continue to give opportunities to these students throughout their lifetime. Our efforts to expand the possibilities for the blind in science, technology, engineering, and art and math have continued despite the pandemic. Last fall, we converted our plans to hold in-person seminars in state affiliates to a national virtual platform. In October and November of 2020, the NFB NFB STEM to You program engaged 102 blind students from across the country in STEAM instructional seminars, in which participants were divided into tracks based on their age and experience. Prior to the program, students were sent materials to facilitate their development of spatial understanding, including tamgram puzzles, snap cubes, tactile graphics, and origami paper and instructions. During the program, students developed the requisite language to help each other understand unfamiliar spatial concepts and had the opportunity to receive authentic instruction in non-visual exploration, which is rarely experienced in public school classrooms. After the program, students were sent additional materials and continued to have access to the mentoring network within the National Federation of the Blind. Our experience with this program helped to inform our virtual implementation of our NFB Engineering Quotient program, which began this week and continues through July 30, 2021. This year's NFB Engineering Quotient program combines best practices from online learning and traditional correspondence courses to facilitate accessible and equitable digital STEAM learning opportunities. Through synchronous and asynchronous activities, our students will develop and utilize their spatial thinking skills. Research has demonstrated that paper folding and drawing are two types of activities that help build spatial thinking abilities. So, NFBEQ activities will revolve around paper folding and tactile drawing. The most exciting transformation is that our blind students, as one of their final learning outcomes, will be creating spatial thinking learning resources and opportunities for our community. We remain committed to mentoring educators and other professionals in the blindness field. Earlier this year, we selected 22 outstanding and up-and-coming teachers of blind students for our 2021 NFB Teachers of Tomorrow cohort. This program provides monthly enrichment and mentoring from NFB members who have an educational background. Our goal is to build a community of practice for these professionals through the National Federation of the Blind. We expect these educators to be part of our transformational work to raise expectations for the blind, and we hope that many of them will teach in future NFB programs. Through our Center for Non-Visual Access to Education, Public Information, and Commerce, we bring the authentic experience of blind people to the intersection of technology innovation. With support from the state of Maryland, we offer intensive accessibility training seminars each month. In addition, our technology staff hosted a number of larger events, such as our Inclusive Publishing Conference, Smart Cities Summit, Educational Technology Seminar for State Superintendents, and Mobile App Development Seminars for iOS and Android. As we begin to consider the next phase of our advocacy work within the technology revolution, we will be considering what the future of our International Braille and Technology Center for the Blind will be. Our physical space in Baltimore, as well as the advocacy, technical assistance, and training we provide, will evolve to support the broader priorities of our movement and to advance our leadership in the field. Often the Federation's partners bring us interesting opportunities to make the capacity of blind people a more meaningful conversation in new places. For example, PINA is a children's app with podcasts, audiobooks, and music. The company has invited our help to improve the accessibility of its platform so that the content can benefit all families. Even more exciting is our consultation on the PINA podcast, Opal Watson, Private Eye. Opal is a curious, brave, and persistent 11-year-old with a thriving mystery-solving business. Opal also happens to be blind. Fortunately, PINA has come to know the Federation and can raise Opal in a growing understanding of our philosophy. Similarly, our friends at Mattel asked us to support their inclusion of Helen Keller in their Barbie Inspiring Women's series. In May, the doll was publicly released, holding a miniature Braille book, and the packaging included readable Braille. We have much more we want to do related to positive portrayals of blind people and with accessible packaging in the future. We continue to investigate partnerships that pursue innovative ways of making visual images and cultural institutions more available to the blind in authentically non-visual ways. 3D PhotoWorks is one of our longest standing partners in this area. In January, together our organizations launched a tactile images partnership that leverages the tremendous resources and brand of Getty Images. The partnership allows us to work collaboratively with museums and others to potentially make any of the approximately 25 million Getty images available in tactile form in institutions or for traveling exhibits. Part of our interest in innovation, in innovative approaches for inclusion and accessibility, is to spark our imagination for what the experience could be at a future civil rights museum for the blind. Transformation comes through thousands of partnership connections, whether they are monthly donations from non-blind donors who support our mission, the tireless efforts of marchers in our movement, or the spirited amplification of our message around the world. We are stronger together. The members of the National Federation of the Blind are the heartbeat of our transformation. Despite the pandemic, after our last convention, we onboarded over 800 new members through our welcoming process. Our Committee on Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion continues to advise on the complexities of examining and expanding diversity and eliminating barriers to full participation within our movement. This spring, we held a training for leaders on diversity, and 600 members participated in our first diversity and inclusion survey. We confirmed that we have more work to do and that we need better strategies for planning and measuring that work. Later this year, we will be building a strategic plan for our diversity and inclusion work to make it more effective, more engaging, and more clearly aligned to our goal of increased participation by a more diverse range of blind people in order to move our federation forward. During the past year, our online meetings helped us recognize we are not adequately hearing from our members who do not have equal access to the internet. This spring, we piloted a new telephone information system for gathering survey data that leverages technologies previously built to support our NFB Newsline program. Over 250 people completed survey responses during the pilot phase, allowing us to prove the effectiveness of the system. We will be adding enhancements to the survey system and expect that it will open new partnership opportunities for us. In 2018, the Federation's Board of Directors established a consolidated code of conduct for members of the organization. Since that time, our membership has continued to engage in meaningful conversations about the code, how we implement it, and how our procedures for addressing misconduct could be better. The members of this organization must be the decision makers about where we go from here. I believe that the work we are doing is transformative, healing, and will make all of us stronger. You should judge for yourself and determine what our future will be. In January of this year, we announced a partnership with RAIN, the nation's largest anti-sexual violence organization. We have worked with RAIN to better understand the complexities of sexual misconduct within our community, including providing level-setting training to 745 leaders across the nation. RAIN has also performed a climate assessment to give us better data about the experiences and perceptions of our members around sexual misconduct, as well as to better understand the existing barriers to reporting within the organization. The results from the RAIN Climate Survey were posted to our website last week, and the data will serve as a baseline to measure progress toward a safer federation in the future. Finally, RAIN has undertaken an extensive review of our code and existing procedures, conducted meetings with key leaders and workshops with a broad cross-section of members, and has prepared detailed recommendations for future response systems. The recommendations were delivered to the Board of Directors just days before this convention and will be considered in the coming months. In parallel with the RAIN partnership, I appointed 6 active members of our federation who are survivors of sexual misconduct or abuse to serve as a short-term task force to steer improvements in our movement. They were charged with only one task: to bring whatever recommendations they felt would improve our response to misconduct, prioritize support for blind people, and build the organization. We have already implemented a number of improvements in our organization as a result of these recommendations. Our progress will be forever shaped by the work of Marcy Carpenter, Cheryl Fields, Sarah Meyer, Daphne Mitchell, Briley O'Connor, and Catherine Webster. We will receive a report from these leaders later in this convention. We offer them our deepest gratitude for the transformational work they have done to make the phrase "safe in the Federation" carry more meaning than ever before. On January 6, 2021, the National Board of Directors established a special committee to oversee and direct an internal investigation of allegations of sexual misconduct by NFB members, participants, or staff at NFB or NFB-affiliated events or facilities, including its affiliated training centers and its state affiliates, as well as the adequacy of the response to such allegations. Our goal was to give our elected leaders as much clear insight as possible about our past, to strengthen and inform improvements for our future. Days before this convention, the Board of Directors made the full interim report of the special committee publicly available on our website as part of our commitment to transparency in this work. Reconciling the past with our expectations today and where we want our movement to go tomorrow is painful, challenging, and emotional work. If we continue to believe in each other, if we continue to work together, and if we stay grounded in the truth that our movement is bigger than any one of us, we will emerge from our uncertainty to a stronger and safer movement in the future. We are doing what we must do to honor the bond of faith we share in our movement. Federation Safe means transforming our movement in ways that allow all of us to move forward together. There are more transformational activities that we have undertaken during the past year that time does not permit me to share. Those I have shared are representative of thousands of other individual stories of blind people who have participated in and been impacted by our progress together. It has been my deepest honor to be a part of this movement for 25 years and to be elected to lead us for the past 7. Despite my best efforts to always do what I felt was right for the people of this movement when confronted with an issue, upon reflection, I recognize that I've sometimes been imperfect, and I regret that I cannot promise you that my future leadership will be perfect. However, I can promise you that I have and always will continue to listen to and learn from the members of this movement. My compass is what I understand to be best in the best interest of blind people. I trust you to judge my actions as well as my heart and commitment. This movement transformed my life from a past limited by low expectations to today, where I have the joy and challenge of undertaking the work detailed in this report with each of you. I am here because you called me to serve. I will never ask of you to do anything that I am not prepared to do myself. I stay here to contribute to our collective advancement because of the love I have for the courage, commitment, and strength that lives in each of the members of this movement. I trust the people of this movement, and I cherish the trust you place in me. These accomplishments only happen because we work together. We are stronger together. We are smarter together. We are safer together. And we are unstoppable together. My Federation family, this is my report for 2021. This is our progress in an uncertain year. This is the bond. This is our bond as a movement. This is the commitment we make together with love, hope, and determination to transform our dreams into reality.
Tossed and blown.
Thank you very much to our virtual choir for that presentation. I'm sorry, I'm going to have to skip a door prize for the moment. We're going to get back to you, door prize team, but we're running a little bit behind, and I want to make sure we give enough time to this next presenter, so I'm also going to cut his presentation short. There's a lot of things that we could say about him. He serves currently as the 19th Secretary of Transportation for the United States. He has a long history of public service and a commitment to listening and enacting strong and progressive policies that are grounded in the experience of real people. And that's why I'm particularly excited to welcome him to our stage this afternoon for the Organized Blind Movement. He is someone that stays grounded in local communities, which we value in the National Federation of the Blind. And as an organization, we have long had a relationship with the career staff at the Department of Transportation. And we're pleased that in a short time, just since February, the secretary has shown a commitment already to being part of that partnership with the Organized Blind Movement here to talk about transformative innovations in transportation is Secretary Pete Buttigieg. We need you to unmute yourself there, Secretary.
There we go. Hello, and thank you very much, President Riccobono. Thanks for having me. Thanks for the introduction. And thanks, everyone, with the National Federation of the Blind. I'm so thrilled for the chance to speak with you today. And I regret that we can't be together in New Orleans, but am all the same so grateful for the chance to be together for an important, convenient conversation like this. As the oldest and largest generation of blind organization of blind Americans, as you know, you are a powerful and important voice on behalf of this community and helping all of America live up to its promises for all of its people. Now, transportation policy can be an enormous engine of opportunity for Americans with disabilities, but as you know, it can also be a major source of inequity. Since the passage of the ADA in 1990, the United States made many important changes to improve accessibility in transportation, but we all know that there's a lot more to do. Too often when a new innovation emerges, there's not enough thought given to how it will impact or how it could be used by people with disabilities. So first, I don't want to miss this chance to thank you for the vital work that you have done on the Pedestrian Safety Enhancement Act, which finally went into effect early this year after more than a decade. When it comes to cars, silence can be deadly for blind and low vision people, and for that matter, for sighted people. And this law helps to ensure that electric vehicles that are so important to achieving our climate goals don't put pedestrians at risk by running without any recognizable sound. So I'm grateful for your advocacy. I'm grateful for your partnership with NHTSA, our National Highway Traffic Safety Administration, to make sure that these vehicles are safe for all pedestrians so that we can all benefit from climate-friendly technology. Legislative victories like this are especially important today because our policies badly need to catch up to our technologies and our way of life. So here at the Department of Transportation, we have been working to apply the lens of equity to every project that we support or are involved with. We're striving to identify gaps in benefits and services for people with disabilities and supporting innovation in accessible transportation. And take automated vehicles as an example. AVs have the potential to help blind and low vision riders get around more easily than ever. But if we've learned anything from the experience with electric cars, it's that we've got to design new technology with the needs of blind and low vision riders and other users with disabilities in mind from the very beginning. That's why we're asking researchers and innovators to work with disability advocates and people with disabilities to advance accessibility in AVs for blind, for wheelchair users, and more. And we're supporting that work through our Inclusive Design Challenge, our Automated Driving System Demonstration Grants, and in partnership with our university transportation centers. We also know that accessible public transit is critically important for people with disabilities. And that's why the Federal Transit Administration prioritizes grant applications that demonstrate a commitment to improving accessibility and ones that include local disability advocates in their planning. FTA and the Federal Highway Administration also fund the Accessible Transportation Technologies Research Initiative, which helps to advance new mobility options for riders with disabilities while eliminating barriers and making transportation more accessible. And I'm pleased to let you know that we are strengthening our Departmental Office of Civil Rights, which frankly was hollowed out by inaction and vacancies during the previous administration. And we're expanding our capacity to handle ADA and Section 504 oversight. We're also hiring a disability program manager to support that effort and working with Irene Marin, who leads our Civil Rights Office. So please, let your members and advocates and partners know that we are eager to engage and eager to partner with you all. Accessibility for us isn't just checking a box. It's not just a buzzword. It's a commitment to ensuring that everyone has the resources and the accommodations that they need to access opportunity. And accessibility isn't just about the technology of the future. It's also about dealing with the infrastructure of the past that we have inherited. We are relying on roads, bridges, ports, and other resources that were built decades, if not a century or more ago, and some of it is literally falling apart, which has significant safety implications for all Americans, but especially for people with disabilities and other underserved and overburdened communities in this country. It's why we need a generational investment in jobs and infrastructure. And it's why we're so excited about the opportunity represented by the President's American Jobs Plan, the core of which is reflected in the historic bipartisan infrastructure framework that was announced recently. This is a deal that's going to create a generation of good-paying union jobs, most of which will be available to Americans whether they have a college degree or not. It's got the largest investment in roads and bridges since the creation of the interstate highway system, the largest investment in passenger rail since the creation of Amtrak itself, and the largest investment in public transit ever, including funding to improve accessibility, so that more Americans can connect to jobs, education, and opportunity. It's also got the largest investments in clean energy transmission and clean water in American history. And it contains $11 billion to improve safety and a new Safe Streets for All program that would focus on safety for all pedestrians, including importantly those with disabilities. And because the administration is looking at every program and policy through that lens of equity, we're seeing to it that across the board, 40% of the climate and clean energy investments in this plan go to underserved communities, including blind and low vision Americans. Of course, there's much more that we can do when it comes to promoting accessibility across our transportation system, from paratransit to guide dogs on aircraft to the Randolph Shepherd program. So you have my word that as long as I'm in this job, you will have an ally and an ear for your voices and your concerns here in the Department of Transportation. According to the CDC, one in four Americans has a disability. And while the nature of those challenges range for different Americans, what we know is that America misses out. Whenever somebody doesn't get to contribute to the economy, society, and culture of our country as they might, we also know that every American may age into a disability, especially those that impact the interface with the transportation systems across our country. So we know with a country full of Americans ready to do so much more, that no country will succeed if a quarter of its population isn't able to fully participate. Disability is also something that cuts equally across race, gender identity, income, language, and more, making this one of the most diverse communities of advocates and activists, internally diverse in such rich and important ways. And many young Americans are stepping up to respond to the call that you have put out to become involved and engaged. We know also that innovations that often begin as an accommodation for Americans with disabilities wind up benefiting everyone in ways that hadn't been fully appreciated at the beginning. Curb cuts first made for wheelchair users that also now make life easier for people with strollers or rollerboard bags. Closed captioning designed for the deaf community, but today used by many hearing people as well. And again, the Pedestrian Safety Enhancement Act that you played such an important role in shaping is protecting everyone in this country. So all of that's to say the investments that we're making right now are so important to every American, whether they realize it or not. And while transportation can be a barrier to accessibility, it can also help break down barriers. And that's the spirit that we're bringing to this department during this administration with your help. So I'm grateful for your leadership. I'm grateful for your partnership. And I'm looking forward to continuing to work together to make sure our transportation system is safer, cleaner, and more accessible to everybody in the years ahead. And again, I thank you for the chance to be with you today. I look forward to continuing to work with you in the years to come.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary. I know that you have a tight schedule. Do you have time for any questions?
Let's do, let's at least sneak in time for one before.
Okay, we're going to go to Raul for a question, but while Raul's getting unmuted, let me just say we appreciate you being here, taking the time, and we know that you're just at the beginning of your journey at the Department of Transportation, and we look forward to many years of being able to work collaboratively. Raul, are you out there?
I'm here, sir.
All right, so go ahead and introduce yourself and ask your question.
All right. Well, thank you for this time. My name is Raul Gallegos, and I'm from Houston, Texas. I serve as the president of the National Association of Guide Dog Users, and that is one of the several divisions of the National Federation of the Blind. I travel quite a bit, and that travel happens on buses, Uber cars, Lyft cars, etc., but also airplanes. And earlier this year, on January 11th, as you know, the Air Carrier Access Act was amended. So it went through quite a few changes in an effort to make it so people stop bringing their counterfeit service dogs on planes. Unfortunately, this has had a weird side effect and a very burdensome side effect on guide dog users who have legitimate service dogs that have been trained to guide us around because that is our preferred mobility tool. Some of these provisions involve filling out forms that the airlines may require us to fill out to attest that these dogs that are traveling with us are legitimate service animals. These forms are not accessible. Sometimes they have to be filled out twice. Once might be the PDF itself, and another time to the airline itself, and they're not consistent. And then furthermore, my dog is right around 80 pounds, and there's language in the Air Carrier Access Act that says that if the airline staff determines that your dog may not fit or doesn't fit within that foot space, then the blind traveler either has to allow the dog to be put underneath or has to reschedule their plans until there's more room available. However, while I have every confidence in the flight staff to be able to handle the things on the plane, I don't know that I have that same confidence that a flight person can determine whether my dog can fit there or not when I'm the one who has the training to be able to make that determination. And I can guarantee that my 80-pound dog with my size 12 shoe can fit very comfortably in that seat underneath. And so I would, my question for you is to ask, would you consider having the Air Carrier Access Act amended so that these types of provisions just go away? We would like them to not be there.
Well, I appreciate you raising this, and I do want to take a closer look at how this situation can be improved. I know this is an area of concern, and obviously there were some public policy goals that rule was intended to achieve, but as you're describing, clearly consequences that may not have been fully understood as it was brought together. And so it's a good example of how we're really relying on your advocacy and voice and ability to educate us on lived experiences of travel to make sure that we're getting this right and understanding the needs of blind and low vision travelers in our aviation system. So I know that there are ongoing discussions about this, and I will make sure that my team will be in touch with the Federation and other advocates to provide updates. And I'll tell you, it's very helpful to hear you describing in a more direct and specific way how this
Thank
can
you.
Create that kind of challenge. So I'll make sure in our conversations that I carry that story with me and appreciate again your shining a light on that challenge.
Thank you very much.
Mr. Secretary, we appreciate you being here. We're looking forward to following up, and we will do that. I do want you to know that we were going to have Mr. Ron Brown, who's president of the National Federation of the Blind of Indiana, ask you a question, bring a little home feel to it. But I know you have a busy schedule, so we will be following up with you and your team, and we appreciate your partnership with the Organized Blind Movement.
Well, thank you, Ron. I'm glad to be in the company of a fellow Hoosier. Thank you, Mark, and everybody who's part of this gathering. And this is our first time together, not our last. So I look forward to the continued partnership.
Great. Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Okay.
How about a door prize for the secretary?
For the secretary and for a powerful report delivered by a powerful force for the National Federation of the Blind and all blind people. Thank you, Mr. President, for a tremendous report you and the work you do. We've got gift certificates, door prizes. You got to remember, if you have to be a part of the general session in the general session when we make you call your name. And to prove that, you can either use the Zoom feature of raising your hand by one of the ways you can do it if you're on the Zoom stream. But if you're on another stream and you can't do it that way, you can always send it a email to prize@nfb.org. That's prize@nfb.org within 10 minutes. You got to send it within 10 minutes and use the code word that I'll give you in just a moment. If you hear your name, you need to know the code word so that you will show that you were here when I called the prize. The code word is NAGDU. Speaking of which, the National Association of Guide Dog Users, NAGDU, but you can just use NAGDU as the code. So we've got five winners of $50 gift certificates to the Independence Market. The first winner is Brian Baldwin of Texas. Then we have Lester Cameron of Georgia. We have Sierra Schmidt of the state of Oregon, not of Jefferson, as the president of the Oregon affiliate had mentioned last night. Sierra Schmidt of Oregon. How about Kathleen Campbell of Colorado? And the final one for this group is Lorna Gray of Florida. Good luck to all of you.
All right. Thank you to the door prize team. Let's go to the Pac-Men.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. This time it's just me solo, one Pac-Man. Scott LaBarre here, or as I'm now known, Scott the Mule. We'll explain more later. I want to first to announce our five winners from yesterday, last evening's opening ceremonies PAC activity. First winner is Jessica Beecham from Colorado. Then we have Sherry Gomez from Colorado. And then we shift further west to Tina Hansen from Oregon. Oh, and here again is another chapter shifting to the southeast, the Tallahassee chapter. Chapters, divisions, affiliates, please sign up on the PAC plan because you could win a prize. And last but certainly not least, Kimberly Evans from Maryland. The only other thing I want to say at this particular update, Mr. President, is we need people to get back to the virtual PAC table. Go to nfb.org/PAC. And if you need help filling out that form, please call us at 877-NFB-2-PAC. That's 877-632-2722. And I just want to say that we know now that over 250 people have looked at our form online, but not that many have filled it out. So if you're having troubles, please do call us at that PAC number. Please get back to the PAC table. We're out.
And thank you for the PAC report. We really appreciate that. And I would encourage you to hit the forward button, actually, to go to the PAC, the virtual PAC table. Our next presenter is going to bring some world perspective to us. You know, the National Federation of the Blind tries to contribute to the understanding around the world about blindness and to the conversation. And we also attempt to learn from what others are doing around the world. Our next speaker was appointed as the UN Special Rapporteur on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities by the Human Rights Council at its 45th session in October 2020. He has a lot of credentials, so I won't have time to share all of them with you, but he holds two research chairs at the Raoul Wallenberg Institute on Human Rights in the University of Lund and Leeds, and at Leeds University, excuse me. He's a graduate of Harvard Law School, and he has been quite involved with and was a key negotiator in the development of the United Nations Convention on the Rights of People with Disabilities. He is not completely new to the National Federation of the Blind. We first got to know him at our Jacobus Ten Broek Disability Law Symposium about a decade ago or so, and we appreciate him bringing his perspective to us, although our nation has not yet ratified the CRPD. We continue to seek what we can learn from the efforts that are happening around the world so that we might raise expectations in this nation. So here to present Stronger Together, how the organized blind movement benefits from the global advancement of the United Nations CRPD is Gerard Quinn.
So thank you very much, President Rigobano. Thank you for the high honor of addressing you and your colleagues today. I'm calling you from my home in the west of Ireland with many, many links to the United States. And we always intuit that we are always stronger together as we look across the ocean. I was very moved by Reverend Fry's invocation that we should reach out and try and impact the world. And my talk very much follows in his spirit. I've often said that the UN treaty without the United States is like Hamlet without the prince. There's such a natural fit. I think there's so much you could do with it, and there's so much we could do with you being present in it. Nearly all the issues you mentioned, President Rick Urbano, in your wonderful speech, resonate very strongly with the jurisprudence of the UN Disability Treaty. And as Secretary Buttigieg said, people want to belong to the economy, to society, and to their culture, and we all need them to belong. And the UN Disability Treaty is an incredibly powerful instrument in leveraging change to make sure that happens. In the brief time available, I just want to do three things, and I will not descend into legalities or niceties. First of all, I want to talk a little bit about the background to the treaty. As you yourself mentioned, President, it's one of the most widely ratified treaties in the world. 182 countries, ranging from every single corner in the world, have now ratified, including your neighbor up north, Canada, and your neighbor down south, Mexico. So I want to just briefly describe what the treaty mechanism is, what kind of implementation and monitoring mechanism is available under the treaty. It's important to understand it does not exist in isolation. It's part of a number of global mechanisms, but it's at the heart of those global mechanisms. So really, if you want to have an impact around the world, you have to be part of the CRPD influencing all those other global mechanisms. Secondly, and very briefly, I just want to highlight some of the substantive innovations in the treaty. that are generally applicable to all persons with disabilities and even intersectionally available to, for example, older people with disabilities, women and children, etc. And there are some provisions in the treaty that have a special relevance to citizens with visual impairments, and I'll explain momentarily. And then thirdly, I just want to anticipate the future a little bit and maybe pose the question, why join? Why ratify? What's in it for you? And I think there are some tangible benefits in it for you. And how can you use it for the benefit of others around the world? So first things first, if I can get my computer to work. Okay. The interesting thing about the drafting of the treaty is that there were draft versions available in the 1980s, just as you were considering drafting the Americans with Disabilities Act. In fact, Sweden and Italy produced drafts in the mid-1980s. The Swedish draft was produced by Bengt Lindqvist, very, very famous blind lawyer in Sweden at the time. It didn't go anywhere at the time, but it set the table for what was going to happen in the next 10, 15 years. When we began drafting the treaty, we widely assumed, everybody assumed, it would be like the Americans with Disabilities Act, an equal opportunities treaty, but now instead of confined to the US or the UK or Australia or Canada, projected out onto a global level. But something really interesting happened in drafting the treaty. A lot of the disability groups were present, and part of the richness of the treaty is due to their presence during the negotiations, said, hang on a minute. The reason why we need these elaborate equality protections is you're not treating us seriously as persons. And that's why there's some fascinating, innovative provisions on the convention on personhood, on your autonomy, on your right to be the self, as the slogan for your organization goes, the right to live your life your way. And that morphs into other things like the right to live independently, and the right to have your voice heard individually as well as collectively. Many people say, and I say, this is actually the heart of the convention, revealing the person behind the mask, so to speak, and getting others to treat personhood seriously. The second interesting thing that happened is we took the equality theory embedded in the ADA and in UK legislation, Canadian legislation, and then broadened it and deepened it. And I'll talk momentarily about that because it's very important and applies throughout the convention. By the way, the convention mingles or co-mingles civil and political rights, like the right to vote, inclusive education, the right to protection from violence and exploitation, with economic, social, and cultural rights, the right to inclusive education, the right to health, and so on and so forth. Importantly to note, where this doesn't exist in a country, it doesn't necessarily force it to exist, but it helps to shape it where it does exist to make sure that if you have an elaborate social security system, that it genuinely supports people and does not entrap them and so forth. We could get into some niceties and technicalities here, but I'll try and avoid that for the moment. Also very important, and the US had a leadership role in this, but maybe others have now taken that leadership role. The treaty applies both to your domestic policy and to your foreign policy. And that would include your development assistance programs around the world. If you can't build inclusive schools in the United States, you certainly should not be using taxpayers' dollars to build non-inclusive schools in Africa and so forth. The EU Disability Strategy, just published 2 months ago, now has a whole section on the European Union in the world. That is to say, based on the UN Disability Treaty, helping other countries to meet standards of the UN Disability Treaty. So the European Union is in the process of becoming a preeminent champion of disability rights worldwide. Personally, I would love to see an alliance between the European Union, and the United States in this regard, maybe a new transatlantic alliance. Also, very important to note in the history of the drafting of the treaty, the World Federation of the Blind, led by Kiki Nordstrom from Sweden, and the World Federation of the Deaf were present and very active during the drafting of the convention. And they managed to ensure that some of the articles, for example, dealing with inclusive education, took specific account of the learning needs of blind students, as well as deaf students, as well as deaf-blind students. And they also collaborated in drafting Article 9 on the right to accessibility. This is not in any other UN treaty. This is specific to this particular treaty and is very important. And in fact, there was a complaint already, an individual complaint to the UN treaty body on inaccessible ATM machines in Spain. And the complaint was won. It's a process under what's called an optional protocol. So if the US ratifies the treaty, it also has the option of opting into the complaints mechanism if it wants to do so. And about two thirds of all of the countries that have ratified the convention have in fact done so. Sorry, my computer is giving me problems as usual. So moving on, what are the treaty mechanisms? I think it's very important to distinguish between international level treaty mechanisms and domestic treaty mechanisms. At the international level, there is now what's called a UN Committee on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities. What it does sounds pretty boring, but it's actually pretty important. It assesses government reports. Every 4 years, your government comes forward with a comprehensive report, and it arrives at conclusions and recommendations to the government based on that report. If your government has opted into the optional protocol, it can additionally receive complaints from individuals and groups. Because you have not ratified the treaty, you cannot nominate somebody to sit on this body. And that's very unfortunate, I would have thought. Nor do you get a chance to vote for who gets to be elected on that committee. Now, so far, there have been some very eminent blind lawyers and other blind activists on the committee. And in fact, the very first chair is a very eminent blind lawyer from Sydney in Australia, Ron McCallum. The point is the US, because it hasn't ratified, is not allowed to nominate its own member and therefore lacks influence over the direction of the committee and isn't even allowed to vote for others who are being put forward by the states themselves. That's just one layer. Another layer is what's called the Conference of States Parties. This is where all 182 states that have ratified the treaty meet once a year for an extended period for conversations, global conversations on challenges, and more importantly, on solutions, sharing solutions with each other. Again, unfortunately, you cannot be part of that, or at least a formal part of it, unless and until you ratify. That's probably the single most important global platform for conversations on disability law and policy. I won't belabor you with most of the other detail, but just be aware that the UN specialized agencies, for example, UNESCO, the ILO, you were mentioning issues about remuneration, the ILO is very engaged on that. And other bodies like the World Intellectual Property Organization, they're all now influenced by the CRPD. In fact, there is a UN disability inclusion strategy only put together 2 years ago, exclusively driven by the UN CRPD, the UN Disability Treaty. The US, of course, is a member of these specialized agencies, but the agenda is not set there, it's set by the UN Disability Treaty. And again, I think you're kind of missing out on the center of gravity in global conversations. Also, there are annual discussions in the UN General Assembly and the UN Human Rights Council on disability issues, where other countries like Canada, New Zealand, and Mexico now take the lead. I won't go into my role, which is rather detailed, but I will say that I do put a spotlight on challenging issues and produce two reports a year. The first one is going to be on war, conflicts, and peace building and disability. And the second one is actually going to be on artificial intelligence, the risks, as well as some of the opportunities into the future. So the international layer is quite complex, but I think it can be crunched down into the treaty body, the conference of states parties that meet once a year, and then the other agencies in the UN system. Just as important, the treaty imagines that there will be a domestic institutional architecture to drive change. This is very unusual. Other treaties don't do this. And the drafters of the Disability Treaty said, we can have stuff out there in the pure ether of international law, but unless there's a way of owning it domestically, it's not actually going to drive change. And that's why the treaty requires states that ratify to have in place a clear focal point within government to drive change, a right to be consulted among civil society with government. We call this the co-production of policy into the future between power and voice. And then ideas are the input of third parties like your US Civil Rights Commission, National Council on Disability, and so forth. So the image here is a triangular image of for change between power and government, voice and civil society, and the power of ideas driving imaginative blueprints for change. That's one of the key drivers for change around the world. And where it's working well, you know that that golden triangle has actually kicked in. So it's like, as it were, a vehicle for internalizing the values of the convention. What about some of the substantive innovations? And I'll be very, very brief here. I mentioned personhood and the anchoring of the convention on personhood. Let me say that that ripples out into all sorts of interesting policy domains and challenges. One of them has to apply, for example, to the future of mental health policy. And the trend now that's very pronounced internationally toward non-coercive models for mental health. And the WHO just 2 weeks ago published an amazing compendium of good practice from around the world away from traditional civil commitment ideals. And that really is kind of personhood ideas coming to life in that particular domain. I mentioned equality too. And of course, the convention is very much beholden to an equality theory or vision. But, and here's the important but, it's broader and deeper than the equality idea, for example, in the British disability discrimination legislation, in the Australian legislation, or in the American legislation. The UN treaty body has adopted what it calls a theory of inclusive equality. This resonates with what Secretary Buttigieg was saying early on. So it's not just about measuring relativities of treatment between me and somebody else. It's much deeper than that. The committee says it's based primarily on recognition of you as a person. It's based on accommodation of the difference of disability and a recognition of accumulated disadvantages from the past. It's also based on notions of a diversity of disability. And last but not least, very, very interesting for us in Europe, maybe slightly less for you in the United States, it also has to do with the need to re-engineer social supports to make sure they liberate and do not entrap people into the future. That's a huge challenge for us in Europe. I can't speak to the United States. So the personhood stuff is important, the equality stuff is important, that it applies across the board to all of the substantive rights like political participation. There's an image of active citizenship, participation, and inclusion in the convention that cuts through everything. Also, the right to accessibility was added in Article 9. And one of the very first things the UN treaty body did was produce an extensive commentary, I beg your pardon, on what Article 9 means particularly in the context of the electronic environment. And as I say, some of the complaints that have gone to the committee have dealt with this. What you, I'm sure you're aware of the Marrakesh Treaty in the NFB. The interesting thing to note is that the Marrakesh Treaty, which relaxes copyright in favor of blind readers, would not exist without the CRPD. The CRPD created the spur for the drafting of the Marrakesh Treaty. You in the United States have at least signed Marrakesh. I'm not sure if you've ratified, but Marrakesh is an offspring of the CRPD. It's not the mothership itself. The mothership itself is actually the CRPD. So what about the future? And I will stop here for sake of time. We have a saying here in my country, if you're not in, you can't win. So you're not really at the heartbeat of changes internationally unless you're formally a part of the actual convention itself. So the question you really should be asking you now is it worth it going again back to the Senate? And if so, what argumentative strategy should be used? I'm an outsider, but I have observed your process in recent years. I think the argument used last time around for ratification, well, they obviously didn't work. It was based on a supposition that the treaty affirms everything in US law, and that the treaty helps project the ADA onto the international sphere, giving Americans the same rights abroad as at home. Well, those arguments clearly didn't work. I would personally say that the CRPD builds on and then complements existing US law. It doesn't break it. It's like the ADA second generation. It just extends its imaginative horizons. A treaty, any treaty, is an act of sovereignty. It's not a time bomb to override sovereignty. And even if there was something ugly that eventuated in the future from it, you can still exercise your sovereign rights to withdraw from the treaty in the future, although I wouldn't like to see that happen. All states enter into treaties in good faith. We call that pacta sunt servanda. It doesn't override national sovereignty, it informs it. And it can inform the domestic courts. They're not obliged to follow it, but if they're persuaded by the logic, perhaps they will take it into account. Essentially, therefore, the treaty allows you to formally enter a global conversation about what personhood, equality, and inclusion mean in the context of disability right around the world. The US has a lot of value to offer, but it simply cannot join that global conversation at present. The way I put it, and in fact, I produced an essay after the last time I spoke before the NFB, saying that the treaty creates a new politics of disability. It sparks advocacy for change where none has previously existed in all sorts of corners in the world, and it helps and widen advocacy for change at home, whether that's in my country or in your country or in Germany or France. Thank you so much, Mr. President. I look forward to interaction.
Thank you very much, Gerard. You know, I can't imagine anybody doing a nicer job of making us feel so good and disappointed about the same time by being off the mothership. So thank you. And really informative in terms of keeping us grounded in why this organization, we need to revisit the CRPD conversation. To see if we can, again, encourage the United States Senate to provide leadership on this issue so that we can be informed by the work that's happening around the world. So thank you for your expertise, and thank you for appearing on our stage again and for being a friend of the Organized Blind Movement. Best of luck to you in your travels around the world. Okay, how about a fit break?
Hey, everybody, we're here with a fit break, and I am so excited to have First Lady and star of Nations Blind podcast, Melissa Riccobono.
Hello, how are you?
Fantastic. And Melissa, I know you are a singer and a musician, so I'm guessing you've got pretty good rhythm, right?
I certainly try. Yes, ma'am.
I think you're going to be able to keep a beat if
keep a beat.
All right. Well, let's try it out. I think we should get everybody to stand up and do a little rhythm fit break.
Yes, stand up.
All right, guys, keep the beat by nodding your head.
Keep the beat by tapping your shoulders. One, two, left, right, left, right.
All right, let's keep the beat by swaying our hips. Woo! Looking good, guys.
Hey, I've got to get my steps in, so why don't we all keep the beat by marching our legs up and down? Left, right, woo! Left, right, left, right, left, right.
Well, you know, sometimes it's just fun to march to your own beat, so why don't everybody just dance around crazy for a little bit?
Woohoo! Keep the beat by slapping your knees. You need to do a little knee bend, up and down a little bit.
All right, thank you for the fit break, and it's great to be keeping the beat. Speaking of keeping the beat, we have been setting the pace as it relates to giving blind people access to voting. You heard some about it in the presidential report, but there's really much more to say about the significant work this movement has done, certainly in history, but over the last 18 months especially, to transform advocacy work into real votes for blind people and others with print disabilities. So here to talk about the impact of the Federation's leadership on voting and voting equality in America is one of our primary counsel that works with us on advancing our priority. She's a partner at Brown, Goldstein, and Levy. She's very familiar to this audience. And so I'd like to welcome back Eve Hill.
All right. I love the walk-on music. Thank you so much, Mr. President. And thank you all for inviting me to speak with you today. It's such an honor and a privilege to be here. And I'm a white woman with brownish red hair and freckles, and I'm wearing glasses, a teal colored jacket, and a matching necklace because I got dressed up. I finally got to get dressed up today. So some 30 years ago, Justin Dart, one of the leaders of the movement to pass the Americans with Disabilities Act, exhorted people with disabilities to vote as if your lives depend on it, because they do. Now, voting is the cornerstone of our democracy. It's how we choose our leaders who represent our values. It's how we hold our leaders accountable. It's how we make our voices heard on the issues that are important to us. It's also the center of the major civil rights struggles in this country. And as the news shows us every day these days, those struggles are far from over. Blind people are at the heart of the civil rights struggle for voting equality. Blind people have faced and continue to face massive barriers to voting. Blind people face inaccessible or burdensome registration requirements. They face inaccessible election websites that prevent them from getting information on elections and candidates. Blind people face transportation and other barriers to even getting to the polls, so lack of convenient polling places keeps blind people from voting. They face check-in processes that undermine their independence and expose their addresses and party registrations to public scrutiny. They face the absence of accessible voting machines in polling places and poll workers who don't know how to set up or use the accessible voting machines that are there. As a result, blind people have routinely had to give up the secrecy of their vote and trust that a third party doesn't, intentionally or unintentionally, spoil their vote or cast their vote incorrectly. Now, over the years, the National Federation of the Blind has steadfastly stood up for the right of blind people to vote and to do so privately and independently, just like sighted voters do. The Federation has advocated for requirements to provide accessible ballot marking devices at polling places, to provide enough ballot marking devices so blind voters' privacy is maintained, to train and supervise poll workers in their use, and to make election websites accessible. A few years ago, the NFB's legal team took on the inaccessibility of absentee voting, which has traditionally relied on mailed paper ballots that were completely inaccessible to blind people. But because the ADA covers all state and local government programs, including voting, and requires those programs to be equally accessible to blind people as to people without disabilities, the NFB succeeded in both the Fourth Circuit and the Sixth Circuit in establishing that absentee voting is required to be accessible to the blind. And accessibility requires an accessible, fillable ballot to be delivered electronically to the voter so they can use their assistive technology to fill it out online. Numerous options for accomplishing this are now widely available, including a variety of professional, commercial, remote, accessible vote-by-mail systems, some of which are appearing in the exhibit hall even now. In 2019, the Federation even went forward and notified every Secretary of State in the country of their obligation to make absentee voting accessible to blind people. And then the Federation, its affiliates, its members, and its lawyers advocated for most of 2020 with 19 states to implement accessible absentee voting in time for the national primaries and the November general election. In a few states, we didn't have to sue because we were welcomed and the state moved quickly to incorporate accessibility into their absentee ballot systems. Colorado is one state that responded to NFB's advocacy to improve its voting systems voluntarily because elections do have consequences. But sadly, most states did not listen. And then the pandemic hit, and states all across the country limited in-person voting and shifted to absentee voting for everyone, leaving blind people caught between the need to vote as if their lives depended on it and risking their lives to vote. As the year went on and the pandemic continued to make people sick and kill over 500,000 people, the Federation could not wait patiently. We kicked into high gear and engaged in legal advocacy with about a dozen states. And we sued in Michigan, Pennsylvania, New York, New Hampshire, Texas, Maine, and Virginia. And given the urgency of the upcoming presidential elections, we sought the extraordinary remedy of preliminary injunctions, which required us to prove our cases at a hearing very quickly. Many of these states actually fought us. They said it was too hard to make an accessible electronic ballot. They argued they didn't have time to get it done in time for the primaries or for the November election. They argued they had to go through slow and complicated procurement processes, even though emergency processes were available. I actually said to one of them, you just bought a bunch of hand sanitizer and you didn't have to go through a procurement process. They argued that there were security concerns with delivering electronic ballots, which is not true. And they even argued that state law prohibited electronic ballots and that the federal law didn't overrule state law, which is also not true. The ADA tells you you have to provide accessible ballots. You have to provide accessible ballots. Doesn't matter what your state law says. We also faced political pushback, unfounded security hysteria, dirty tricks and falsehoods, and we faced courts who were unwilling to push the states to do the right thing. But in each case, except Texas, the Federation and its members forced the state to provide some form of accessible electronic ballot for the November general election. And as the president said, over 11,000 people used those ballots just in the states we sued. Even though many of those states did not do a good job getting the word out about the accessible ballots, or even in some states didn't do a good job of making those ballots really accessible. In fact, voters with disabilities last year across the board turned out and voted in larger numbers than in previous years. So the Federation has showed that if voting is accessible, blind people will turn out to vote. And every one of those votes mattered. As Barack Obama said, there's no such thing as a vote that doesn't matter. So blind people are overcoming the barriers and voting as if your lives depend on it, because they do. But what next? Well, in Pennsylvania and Michigan and Virginia, the states have agreed to implement professional, remote, accessible vote-by-mail systems They did it in the November elections, and they're going to do it in future elections. In New York, the state was required to provide accessible PDF ballots by email, even though that was not the solution we preferred because of the difficulty of making PDFs accessible across all platforms. Maybe you can hear the thunder in my background now. Because of the difficulties both the state and voters had using those accessible PDFs in New York, we are negotiating with New York and trying to get them to implement a professional accessible absentee ballot system in future elections. In New Hampshire, the state implemented a professional system for November, and we're negotiating with them to hopefully make their election website accessible and provide a professional remote accessible vote by mail system in future elections. In Maine, we sued the state and four major cities, and they have all agreed now to implement an accessible HTML ballot in future elections and to allow voters to return their ballots electronically. In Texas, the unusual one, the court refused to decide our case at all, so we dismissed it, and we've written a demand letter to a county because now the state has said it has no control over what the counties do, so we have to sue the counties. But there are still some remaining issues. Too many states continue to offer no method of electronically delivering an accessible ballot to blind voters that they can mark on their own computers. Too many states are relying on inadequately accessible PDF ballots, which make the process difficult both for the voter and for the state. And we're preparing to file complaints with the Department of Justice about those states. And most states don't allow blind voters to electronically return their accessible ballots. So blind voters must purchase a printer, print their ballots, get them in the right envelope, sign the envelope, and return the envelope by mail, usually with the help of another person, which undermines the privacy of their vote. This is not equal access. And mechanisms such as professional remote accessible vote by mail systems, as well as email and fax, exist to accomplish electronic return. States refusing to allow blind voters to electronically return their ballots are relying on overblown security concerns that they could overcome. In some states, they already overcome those barriers, excuse me, and allow overseas voters to return their ballots electronically. And the astronauts on the space station returned their ballots electronically last year. But these states won't allow blind people the same access. Unfortunately, the major voting bill introduced in Congress right now doesn't provide for electronic return of ballots for blind voters. And the NFB has taken that issue on. So instead of us moving forward, as voting rights moves forward, blind voters are again at risk of being left out of voting rights developments. Once again. So it's up to the Federation and all of us to get accessible electronic voting offered by on a state-by-state basis. So here's my hope for us. I hope that we will advocate with all of our state and local voting officials to implement professional, remote, accessible vote-by-mail systems and methods of electronic return. I hope all of you will share the stories of your voting experiences trying to use inaccessible voting systems. And I hope you'll contact Valerie Yingling if you're willing to take action to challenge your state's inaccessible absentee voting system. Getting an equal right to vote has always been a struggle. It shouldn't be, but it is. But the Federation is up for the challenge. And as Susan B. Anthony once said, someone struggled for your right to vote, use it. The Federation and each and every one of you have struggled and continue to struggle for the right of blind people to vote equally, privately, and independently. So above all, I hope you will use that precious right to vote for the things you care about, the candidates you believe in, and the issues that are important to your community and your country. Because when we vote, we are stronger together. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Eve. I hope you use that lightning and thunder in your, you know, presentations on our behalf, you know, in the cases we bring.
I always bring the thunder in court.
Yeah, that's what I figured. Thank you for your work and overview and for your carrying out our priorities in the voting realm. So keep up the great work. Keep pushing them. And we'll look forward to your updates very soon. Okay, we need to move to our next presentation because this individual also has a short window to be with us, and we're glad that she is here. This is Transformational Leadership in Partnership with the Blind. You heard Eve talk about Colorado. raising expectations for all blind Americans by enacting a law, which we heard in the roll call, is also been repeated in Hawaii. She has the distinction of being the 39th Secretary of State for the great state of Colorado, also apparently the youngest Secretary of State in the nation currently. She's bringing new perspectives to the work in Colorado, and she has demonstrated herself as a true champion for equality for the blind through her work to offer electronic delivery of voting, and now with the law in Colorado, electronic return. So here for some remarks about leadership for the rest of the nation to pay attention to is Colorado's Secretary of State from, let's see, Louisville, Colorado. Here's Gina Griswold.
Colorado, Rocky Mountain High. I've seen it rain and fire in the sky. Shadow from the starlight, softer than a lullaby.
Good afternoon. Thank you for having me here. I'm Gina Griswold, Colorado Secretary of State. And the song you just played is right on point. We're actually up in the Rocky Mountains right now, breathing the fresh air, and just so happy to join you. Thank you to President Rico Bono and everyone at the National Federation of the Blind for having me. In Colorado, we're so fortunate to work with Scott LaBarre and his team, including Dan Burke and Curtis Chung. It's an honor to be speaking with you at your 81st annual convention. As Colorado Secretary of State, my office oversees all statewide elections, making sure all of our 64 county clerks are working in concert to ensure Colorado's elections are secure and smoothly ran. Now, Colorado is continually among the nation's leaders in voter registration and turnout. In last November's general election, in the midst of the pandemic, over 3.2 million Coloradans cast a ballot, more than in any election ever before in state history. Our turnout rate among active registered voters was an impressive 86.5%. While 2020 was a continuation of excellent voter turnout in the state, it's not by coincidence. The fact of the matter is, we work hard to make sure voting is as easy as it can be. I'm proud of the fact that Colorado's election model is the nation's gold standard. We utilize Vote by Mail for All, in which every registered voter is mailed a ballot, which they can return either by mail or in any one of our nearly 400 drop boxes throughout the state. And 94% of voters choose to vote their mail ballot. We have early voting, where most voting centers open 2 weeks before an election. We have automatic voter registration and same-day registration, enabling eligible voters to register and vote even on election day. This hybrid of voting by mail and early in-person voting really all comes down to one key, simple tenet, access. Colorado's elections are the nation's gold standard because we are able to provide voters various methods by which to cast their ballot while maintaining security. And when voters know that casting a ballot is secure and easy, they will enthusiastically participate. But access means a lot of different things to a lot of different people, and in Colorado, we work hard to make sure that every eligible voter has equal opportunity to participate in our democracy. And I'm proud that by working closely with the National Federation of the Blind, Colorado continues to set the standard in voting for Americans with no to low eyesight. Just this past legislative session, the state legislature passed the Ballot Access for Voters with Disabilities Bill, a collaborative effort with the NFB chapter in Colorado and State Senator Jesse Danielson, that uses technology to revolutionize voting for Americans with low to no eyesight. Starting back in 2019, blind, visually impaired, and voters with a qualified disability were able to receive a ballot electronically. The problem was, after they received their ballot, voters had to print it out, vote, sign it, and physically have it returned to their county clerk. This latest legislation removes that additional hurdle of physically returning the ballot by allowing those specific voters who are blind, visually impaired, or otherwise unable to manipulate their ballot to vote and return their ballot using similar methods that our military overseas currently uses. While we steadfastly protect election access, we are equally protective of election security. Thanks to the measures that we have in place, Colorado has been recognized by the Department of Homeland Security and the Washington Post as the safest state in which to cast the ballot today. Colorado overwhelmingly uses a voter-verified paper ballot. None of our voting equipment is connected to the internet. And after every election, we conduct a risk-limiting audit, which proves to a high statistical degree of certainty that the results of the election are correct. What increases security of electronic ballots is the fact that we use a secure transfer portal, which is encrypted. This is similar technology that allows military voters stationed overseas and American voters living in other countries to have their voices heard. And now it's another way that blind voters can have their voices heard as well. Our commitment to access also extends to the technology we've developed to make voting easier. And once again, the NFB has been an essential partner. This last fall, we implemented ballot tracking capabilities statewide, which informs voters via text or email of the status of their ballot from when they're mailed to when they're received by their county clerks. The results after one election were extraordinary, with over 1.7 million voters using the system to track their ballot. That's 53.8% of all ballots returned. We're currently working with the NFB Colorado chapter to make the system work even better by optimizing mobile accessibility features. Tracking ballots is an invaluable way to add transparency to elections by removing all doubt that a voter's ballot has been received. Colorado has also implemented a mechanism by which voters can address signature discrepancies via their cell phone called Text to Cure. In a vote-by-mail system, a voter signature is what the clerks tend to use and election judges to prove that a ballot belongs to the right person. If a signature on a ballot doesn't match a signature on file for that voter, the voter is given a chance to fix the discrepancy before the vote is counted. Before the vote is not counted. TextSecure gives voters the opportunity to easily and conveniently fix those signature issues by making sure our voices are heard. Last election, 11,085 ballots that otherwise would not have been counted were cured or fixed by voters using this new technology. We consulted with the NFB Colorado in developing this feature and continue to work with the NFB to improve it to suit the needs of blind voters. The NFB plays an important role in how we conduct in-person voting as well. Colorado has solicited and received important feedback on accessible voting devices, feedback that has in turn been forwarded to our voting system developers and implemented in elections. These voting system developers can take what they learned from Colorado and implement changes nationwide, improving accessibility for blind voters from coast to coast. What we achieve together in Colorado truly has an impact that makes tangible improvements for voters nationwide. Colorado also has a Voter Accessibility, Independence, and Privacy Task Force, comprised of local and national disability advocates, that keeps us improving and making sure we have elections that work for everyone. The National Federation of the Blind is a leader on this task force, and their input into our elections is a key reason that we can call ourselves the nation's gold standard. Benjamin Franklin once said, without continued growth and progress, such words as improvement, achievement, and success have no meaning. Any success we've enjoyed up to this very day is stagnant if we refuse to build on it. And if there's one thing we've learned during the past year, it's that one of the greatest risks to democracy is complacency. As Colorado's chief election official, I am committed to creating an election model for all the people. But to make sure we are reaching for that more perfect union, we need every state to ensure that all eligible people, regardless of zip code, color of skin, or ability, have access to free and fair elections. That is where you all come in. I urge you to reach out to your state's election officials, and if they aren't already in place, urge them to adopt vote by mail for all, early voting, accessible drop boxes and voting centers, same day and automatic voter registration, and accessible elections for all Americans. Democracy is only as strong as our ability to participate in it. And together we can build a democracy that works for all Americans. Thank you for your work and continued partnership. And thank you again for having me today.
Thank you much, Madam Secretary. We appreciate your leadership, and anything you can do to influence the other secretaries of state to follow your lead, we'd really appreciate it. And we're really glad to have you as a champion along with our Colorado affiliate to show other states how to do accessibility, security, and voting all in one package. So thank you for being with us at this convention.
Thank you so much. And you got it. Colorado is the nation gold standard for a reason, and everybody looks to us. So we'll cross our fingers that they learn something from our partnership.
We're sending them all your way. So keep up the great work. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Let's have a door prize or maybe a couple of sets of door prizes to catch up on door prizes.
Absolutely, Mr. President. Our first prize is going to be $25 Visa gift cards. And the code word, well, code words, are NFB Bell Academy, one of our wonderful programs.
That's a long word, isn't it?
It's quite long. remember, please raise your hand or email prize@nfb.org within the first 10 minutes. Our winners are Pauline Lampontaine from Maine, Umberto Avila from Washington State, Lydia Washington from Maryland, Joy Orlando from California, Elizabeth Dunn from Michigan. Remember, the code words are NFB Bell Academy. Please raise your hand or email prize@nfb.org. Off to you, Bennett.
Okay, yeah. How about another one? As Mr. President has suggested we do, I'm happy to do this. We've got some $50 certificates, gift certificates to the Independence Market here that we can give away. And our code word here is autonomous. I'll spell that, AUTONOMOUS, autonomous. So that means that alone you'll get these as you win, if you win. And my five winners are Mary Dunphy of New York, Barbara Alexander of Louisiana. We've got Margarita, I'm going to get this right, Sevier, S-E-V-I-E-R, sorry, Texas, Fallon Minicello, Florida. And finally, we have Sharonda Huffman. I'm sorry, Sharonda Huffman. I should have got your name before that. And it's in Maryland. She's from Maryland. You got 10 minutes to either raise your hand or send in to the prize at nfb.org with the code word autonomous, and one of you five will be winners.
You're not required to spell it correctly to get the prize, right? That's just
maybe their names should be spelled right, but otherwise.
Yeah, well, that makes sense. All right. Thank you, Dora Prize. Folks, we'll be back with you before the end of the session for some more prizes. Go ahead, Bennett.
I just said we'll be here. I'm looking forward.
All right. Great. So continuing the conversation about voting, and this is an important presentation. Of course, we support accessibility in voting, and we believe that that does not have to come at the expense of security. So often security is used as the reason not to provide full access. And in this organization, we believe that both can be done together. When it comes to accessibility in other realms, we promote companies viewing accessibility like security at a very high level, and treating them as important, both important aspects of development of software or websites. And this next presentation is in line with that. It's a stronger future together through a commitment to full participation, building the tools to empower all to vote. And this gentleman I've had the opportunity to get to know very recently. Mr. Tusk has a long history of a number of ventures that he has spearheaded, everything from capital ventures to political consulting. But what brings him to our stage today is his work through his family's foundation to fund and really lead the national campaign to build mobile voting tools for United States elections that are accessible and secure. And he's using his own private efforts to do this. I had the opportunity to talk with him about some of his political experience and how the idea of getting more people to vote is what really drives his interest in making great policy for the nation. Now, there's a lot of other things I could tell you about him and his tremendous skills, and we could tell you about his commitment to his family and the things that he does. But I think the thing that should tell you the most about who he is, about his tenacity, his heart, is this line, which is at the end of his biography on the web, which says, he spends his free time worrying about the Mets. Here's Bradley Tusk. Yeah, we will rise up, rise up, rise up. We will rise up, rise up, rise up. We will rise up, rise up, rise up strong. No one will stand alone.
Well, thank you so much. And yeah, I spend, especially after you asked my wife, far too much time worrying about the Mets, but I'll be at the game tonight. But Mark, thanks so much for the introduction and really to all of you for giving me a chance to be here and to speak with you. It's a tremendous privilege. I spent the first 15 years of my career working directly in government and politics. Worked in New York City at City Hall for Mike Bloomberg. I was the deputy governor of Illinois, worked in the US Senate in Washington, city government, state government, federal government, executive branch, legislative branch, ran campaigns. So I really feel like I've seen government and politics from pretty much every angle. And the main takeaway I had after 15 years is that the inputs shape the outputs. If you want certain policy outputs, if you want certain, you know, laws or outcomes, the political incentives have to be there to line up with them. And if not, it doesn't happen. Having worked with a lot of politicians over the course of my career, the conclusion I reached is they really, really need the validation and affirmation that comes with holding office. This may not be true for 100% of them, but generally speaking, you know, being somebody matters so much to them. It fills this hole in their psyche that they're always going to put staying in office ahead of everything else. And it doesn't make them bad people, it just makes them human. And my guess is if you look back at the Greek Senate or the Roman Senate or any other democracy in history, you'd find the same thing. The people who run for office care about staying in office. About 10 years ago, I ran a bunch of campaigns for Uber to legalize ride sharing all over the US. And at the time, Uber was a small tech startup and the taxi industry was very powerful, kind of politically connected. And the way that we took them on and beat them was that we mobilized our customers and said to them, if you like this service and you want to be able to keep using it, please let your elected officials know. And through the app, they were able to text or tweet or email or in some way tell their city council member, their state senator, the governor, the mayor, whoever it was, that they wanted this thing to stick around. A couple of million people ended up doing that, and we won in every single market in the US. And I remember thinking at the time, like, wow, it's not that people are totally apathetic and disengaged. They just don't necessarily want to do what it takes to go vote in person. What if you could vote in the way that we just mobilized all these people to argue for ride sharing? So it was an idea that was kind of in the back of our heads. And then over the succeeding years, blockchain technology really improved, and it went from being an idea that seemed like, hey, wouldn't this be cool, to we can do this. I've been lucky in that my work in venture capital and technology, I've made some money and decided to put it to good use by creating this mobile voting project. And we kicked off in West Virginia in 2018. Mac Warner, who spoke on a panel here a couple of days ago, is the Secretary of State. He gave us our first chance at it. It worked. We've now held 20 elections across 7 different states where it's been available either for people with disabilities or for deployed military or both. We've seen states like West Virginia allow mobile voting to be available for all people with disabilities. We just heard from Secretary Griswold about Colorado doing something very similar. And so far it's worked. Turnout on average has doubled in mobile voting elections. The National Cybersecurity Center has audited every single mobile voting election. Every single one has come back clean. Now, we have to keep improving the technology. We need to keep making it as secure as possible. But if you look at all the problems we already see with voting machines, with paper ballots, we know no system is perfect. And we know the mobile voting, you know, has the potential, as Mark said, to both make it radically easier for people to cast their ballot and be more secure than any other system. Now, the use case for the blind is obvious to everyone here, which is you should be able to vote with complete privacy. You should be able to enjoy the same rights that every American has when it comes to voting. And you should be able to do that by using the same technology that helps you do so many other things all day long. You should be able to vote on your phone. It's really hard for anyone to even argue that that shouldn't be the case. And yet, it is still an uphill climb. So to us, that's why our work with the NFB has been so meaningful to us. And we're so grateful for your partnership. Because to us, the use case for the blind is obvious, but the use case for everyone is obvious, which is we have a government that simply doesn't work. It can't function because all of the incentives to stay in office are aligned towards dysfunction. Just take as a random example, say you're a Republican congressman from Florida. And by the way, this applies equally to both parties. Turnout in your primary is 12%. Because of gerrymandering, the only election that matters is the primary. The general election is a foregone conclusion. Of that 12% who turn out in the primary, half in this example are NRA members. You may know, if you're this congressman, that people shouldn't be able to walk in off the street and walk out with an AK-47. You may look at shootings in schools and churches and Walmarts around the country and say, I've got to do something about this. But at the end of the day, you also know that if you were to vote for the assault weapon ban, in the next primary, you would lose your seat and your political career would be over. And you're not willing to do that. And this is true of people in both parties, every single level of government, municipal, county, state, federal. And it's the problem isn't them, the problem is us. We either expect there to be some transformational leader who can just fix all of it. Everyone who runs for president promises that, it never happens. Or we expect our politicians to act outside of their own self-interest. They've never done that before. They're never gonna do that going forward. But now take the same example in Florida. And imagine the turnout in the primary were 40 or 50% simply because everyone could vote on their phone. If you look at all the polling around assault weapons, you would see that the majority of people don't think it should be that easy to obtain one. So as a result, the same member of Congress who voted against the assault weapon ban to stay in office before with 12% turnout in the primary, now with 50% turnout in the primary, is voting for it for the same reason, to stay in office. We changed their political self-interest. And by doing that, it changed the outcome of the law itself. So we don't have to have a government that can't make decisions. We don't have to have a government that can't agree on anything. We don't have to have a government that can't get things done. We don't have to have a democracy that focuses only on the needs of a few, either the ideologues who vote in every primary or the special interests who are able to move money and votes in primaries. We don't have to have a system where no one can succeed, but it requires change. The kind of change that you guys are thinking about here requires thinking differently. And look, all of the people who like things the way they are aren't going to say, yeah, I'd prefer to keep my power the way it is. I don't want anyone else to vote. They say it's not secure. It's not safe. We'd love to make it easier to vote, but we just can't do it because we can't take the risk. You see that right now in the debates over new voting laws in places like Georgia or Texas. And that's what they're going to say with us, too. It's what they're already saying, which is, sure, we would love mobile voting, but we can't do it simply because it's too risky. That's just not true. We've already seen that in 7 states and 20 jurisdictions, and people with disabilities can now tell you that firsthand in places all across the country. So we need to keep working on the technology to make sure that it's secure, to make sure that it works, that it's robust as anything out there. We've got to keep working on legislators around the country to follow West Virginia's lead, follow Colorado's lead, make mobile voting available for all people with disabilities. We've got to build a movement that's willing to demand that it become easier to vote. This is only going to happen if millions of Americans step up and say, I ought to be able to vote this way. It's secure, it's safe. And the only reason I'm not allowed to is because the people in power don't want to lose power. That is not an acceptable reason to prevent progress and change. And we've got to do it quickly because right now we're living in a world where every policy ends up being a failure. Every kind of political cycle ends up imploding in some way. And every time that we can't get something done, that we can't rebuild our bridges and roads because we can't pass an infrastructure bill, we can't figure out who is and isn't a legal American, because we can't resolve immigration. We can't figure out how to make healthcare affordable or education, you know, more accountable and have higher standards. All of that is because all of the incentives in the system right now are designed to prevent things from happening. And that's because turnout is low, and that's because it's simply too hard to vote, unquestionably for the blind, but in reality for everybody. And we can't keep letting that happen. So yes, this is a hard problem and it's a tough project. Technology can be really hard. Building movements, as you know better than anyone, is really hard, but you've done it successfully and hopefully we can do it together again here. And in this case, it's really our only way forward. It's the only way forward to a democracy that truly works. Only way forward to a democracy that truly, to a government that truly functions, to a country that can finally solve problems like climate change or guns or education or healthcare, immigration or so many others. The way that we're going as a country right now just isn't sustainable. You can't fail to get anything done for decades on end and expect to stay together as a successful country. So I don't know that we even last as one country if we don't find a way to change things. I truly believe that mobile voting is the way to change it. That's why I've put, you know, my money and my time and my connections and whatever else I have to offer into this movement, because I believe that it's the only way to save our democracy. It's the only way to make voting far easier and more accessible for people with disabilities and people all across our country. And so I really am just here to say thank you. You guys have been a tremendous partner to us. We've been working together in lots of different states to try to make people listen and understand why this is so important. And you guys have been among our best partners in the whole country. So the main point was just to say thank you to all of you. Thank you for your partnership. Thank you for listening. Thank you for being part of this movement. We're going to keep fighting for you, and we're really grateful to be doing this with you. So I probably went a little under on time. I suspect no one's really going to mind that too much. But Mark, I'll throw it back to you. And if anyone does have questions, I'd be more than happy to answer them.
Well, Bradley, thank you for that. What's your feeling about the timeline for really proving this technology? What's your prediction? How long is this going to take?
It's a great question. So I think we can have new technology built and ready in a little under 2 years. And then the question is, from when the technology works to when everyone can stop making excuses to using it, how much time elapses there, right? So I am shooting for 2028 to make where every American can vote in elections on their phone. It's a little bit of an arbitrary date. Now, look, my view is if we did nothing at all, eventually technology always wins. So in 25 years or 40 years, in some amount of time, mobile voting would happen on its own. But every year that doesn't happen is a year that we can't get anything done in Washington and our state houses and our cities all over the country. So every year that we can make it happen faster is a year that we can help save our democracy. And so, you know, my view is if we can do everything right, if we can all work together well, by 2028, everyone can vote this way. And that's my prediction.
Excellent. Well, we're going to try to hold you to it. So we appreciate being able to work with you and having this as one of our strategies to increase the participation of the blind in the voting process. And your partnership, your sponsorship of this convention, your thought leadership in how we can advance opportunities for all voters, but including voters who are blind, is really powerful. So thank you for this new partnership. We look forward for many, many years to come, even after 2028. So thank you for being here.
Absolutely. We'll find something to talk together. Thank you so much for the opportunity. I'm really grateful for it.
Go Mets.
Absolutely. I'm on the game.
All right. Thanks. So before we get to our final door prize, a reminder that the next session will start at 6:30 convention time here on the East Coast. I want to call to your attention the Empowering Survivors panel that will be happening at 5:15 convention time this evening. Obviously, it's in the agenda. You can find it in the app. The survivor-led task force has conducted so many tremendous gatherings this week as part of our educational efforts, and I truly appreciate their continued efforts to lead us on these issues. So I call that panel to your attention. Also, delegates or those serving on the nominating committee specifically, you should have a link in your email to the nominating committee meeting, which will also kick off promptly at 5:15 via Zoom. If for some reason you don't have that link in your email, you should contact Beth Braun, bbraun@nfb.org, as soon as possible. I think that's all the announcements that I have. So, Bennett, Kenya,
gonna Kenya's turn.
Final door prize. All right.
Yes, sir. We are giving away $75 Visa gift cards. The code word is Braille. We love literacy around here. Our first winner is Orlando Bontagan from Guam, Jessica Scannell from New Jersey, Dick Walker from Arkansas, Verdina Gillette Sims from North Carolina, Nancy Aguilera from Missouri. And again, the code word is Braille. Please raise your hands or email prize@nfb.org.
All right. Thank you very much to the door prize crowd. We will stand